I didn't plan on saying anything, but I had debated and figured I'd share this. Because in my Facebook post, and Aunt Mary, thank you for reading that eulogy. For anybody who read the Facebook post, you made it. I beg, borrowed, and stole a lot to put in the eulogy. And, but one of the things that I mentioned in that post was, you know, how Dad left on his own terms, and I said, maybe I'll get around to telling that story someday. And I want to share that on social media, but I don't have time. Literally don't have time to type it out. Because usually I do that when I'm in the bathroom. And I don't have time to go to the bathroom. But, so I figured, now I got everybody here and I've got the time, figured I'd share the story. It is kind of funny, but it is poignant as well. And I'm going to try to get through it without choking up too much. So it was July 5th. It was the last day of his life. And, you know, he needed answers. His lung had collapsed, and he wanted to know if there was any chance that, he knew he had cancer. He knew it was the end, you know, but he wanted to know if there was any chance that lung could get reinflated, or if it was just going to be, you know, straight downhill from there. And so it's like pulling teeth without pliers to get doctors to talk to you about that sort of thing. And nothing against doctors, you know, it's just, you know, you got the cancer doctor, and then you've got the esophagus doctor, you got the nurses, and the left hand and the right hand doesn't always. So everybody means well, but the communication just, you know, and the old man, he's just, God, can somebody tell me, you know, and finally, you know, we had somebody come in and reckon with us, you know, God bless his heart, I can't even remember what his name was, but he was a youngster, he is a young guy, Dad asked him some questions point blank, and he said, no, he's like, yeah, that lung's not going to get reinflated, you know, so sorry to tell you that, but, and we told him, you know, we appreciate the candid, you know, response. So that was one thing he could cross off his list. He wanted to know what are the chances that we can get the lung green, because at that point we were thinking hospice, we were thinking palliative care. What would it take to get him back into the, and, you know, selfishly, I'm thinking, God, let's get this back in the house so I can bring Merrick up, you know, to see him one last time. We didn't want to take Merrick into the hospital, especially not in the ICU. There's a little bit of COVID, but God knows what else is going on that floor. And so we didn't want to bring the boy up. So selfishly, I'm thinking, God, let's get the old man home, and we can, you know, bring Merrick up and see him one last time. But Dad, yeah, you know, he had other questions too, so in the eulogy, I, you know, it said that he wasn't afraid of death, and I believe that's true. I believe he accepted that he wasn't afraid of it. But the only time I ever heard my dad ever say that he was afraid of anything was on that day. He's talking to the hospice nurse, you know, and he was trying to explain, he didn't want to inconvenience anybody. He didn't want anybody to take care of him, right? He wanted to take care of others. He didn't want to be taken care of. And so he's like, you need to explain to me how I'm going to be able to sit in my easy chair and go to the bathroom and come back. You know, he wasn't sure how he could work that out with hospice care. That was the other thing, is the lung going to reinflate or not? And then he wanted to know how he could, and he's like, how are you guys going to transport me into the house? How are you going? He was really focused on the logistics of all these things, and, you know, the hospice nurse, as she's trained to do, you know, don't worry about it. Just don't worry about it. We'll take care of it. We'll take care of it. Don't worry about that shit. We'll get you on a bed. We'll get you on a gurney. So he's like, okay, but he was explaining to her, he's trying to provide some context as to why he was so concerned about these things. He said, you know, the other day I went to get up and use the bathroom, and when I was done using the bathroom, I didn't think I'd get back in that bed, and that scared me. He said that. So I don't think he was afraid of dying. He wasn't afraid of bears. He wasn't afraid of those. But he acknowledged at that point that he didn't think that he would be able to make it back to his bed. He said, and that's scary. She said, yeah, don't worry about it. We'll hook you up with a bedpan. If it's not a bedpan, it's a catheter. And you know, Dad, he's thinking, God, these nurses are going to have to clean up my ass. You know, is my wife going to have... And he's got a tube draining fluid out of his lung. He's like, now who's going to take care of that? You know, he's just... And we're all sitting there like, dude, don't worry about it. Like, they're going to pump you so full of morphine. Like, you just, it's going to be, you know. And so the hospice nurse was really good. She went through all this stuff. She answered his questions as best she could. And then towards the end, you know, the hospice nurse was like, I'm sorry. Was that information overload, you know? And then mom was like, Earth to Ed, you know? Are you okay? And he's like, oh, yeah, sometimes it feels good just to space out. and yeah, he was spacing out all right. He was on his way out, you know. And so we were like, all right, well, we got a lot to discuss. We got a lot to dissect. We've been given all the information we need. You know, so mom and I went out to, I don't know, I was going to use the bathroom in the lobby or whatever. But then they were going to move him. They were going to move him from that ICU room to another room because he had to use the, he had to go to the bathroom, and they didn't have a commode in the ICU. Well, and maybe I'm getting this mistake. however it shook out, they were going to move him up to this room, and it was there that he was going to, you know, use the facilities. And so mom and I are just waiting in the waiting room on that particular floor, and the nurse came out and said, his oxygen's dropping, and you're going to want to be... in that room right now. So we went in there and we watched him die. Now that nurse said that she begged him to use a bedpan. Begged. And I think it does in some part go to he just didn't want to, you know, even clean up his poop. but beyond that, mom and I talked about it a little bit after the fact, and we're speculating, and there's no way to really know. But mom tends to think that he refused to use the bedpan, and he wanted to, and I guess I should just take a step back. What happened was that when he went to get out of the bed, you know, he did his business. But getting back into the bed is what did him in. That's when his, you know, oxygen dropped. We weren't there for that. You know, we wanted to give him some privacy and all that. But mom thinks that he thought that he was up for a challenge. He wanted to see if he could do it. He wanted to see if he could still, you know, do it. And that very well may be. That's likely. I tend to think that he knew that he wouldn't be able to. And who knows if that's true? I don't know. Either or, the conclusion came on his terms. And so there's part of this that is, you know, the grace and the dignity and, you know, Dad wanting to do things his way, or maybe he didn't want to inconvenience anybody. And then, guys, part of it is that I don't think, and excuse my language, I don't think he wanted to live in a world where he couldn't take a shit without somebody cleaning it up. You know? And, so I wanted people to know that. Because I feel it is consistent with how he lived his life. You know, and I don't know anything, you know, about prior to my birth. You know, I've heard stories. So I know it's secondhand and thirdhand. All I can talk about is my perspective of him as my father. But, you know, he wanted to take care of people. He didn't want to be an inconvenience. He wasn't afraid of the end. And whether it was because he was up for a challenge or because he just hunted to slip out the back door without telling anybody. The old man left on his own accord. So, figures y'all want to know.
Thanks, man.
Thanks.